doubt about it, these are weird times. If you are feeling frustrated and find yourself asking why, do not despair and don't run away. Or maybe run away with me for a spell, for I have an adventure waiting for you. Welcome, everyone. I am Deborah DePietro, and this is Wonder Around the World. Each week, we will have a guest either from my country, the USA, or from someplace else, and we will be asking ourselves the question, what do we love about our home? What do we love about our communities and our countries? I just felt like during this time of division and stress and anxiety, it would be nice to do a new show where we come together and connect with people from all around the world and focus on something positive. So I hope you're ready to come and wonder and discover along with me. So ready to find out what we're going to learn today? All right, let's go and introduce today's guest. And I'm super excited to bring her on. Her name is Francie Desmone, and she is an artist healer and certified wilderness first responder. She's a lady of many talents here. She's been an acupuncturist for the last 20 years. She's an avid sailor and a chef. Francie wraps all the things together to create her special blend of acute observation and humor. Natural health has been her passion for 35 years, and during the pandemic, she shifted over to coaching and creating. As a fiber artist, she brings beauty, comfort, and joy with her creations. Currently living in the Midwest, Francie looks forward to moving back to the sea. Francie, welcome to the show.
Oh, thanks for having me on, Deborah.
Well, it's a pleasure. I know that a mutual friend of ours recommended you highly, and I was super excited about meeting you. And I guess you kind of could gather from my introduction here. I just wanted to do kind of a fun, you know, positive, love-focused show about, you know, some good things going on and what we love. And so why don't we start off just asking you, how are you doing? How is life?
Today?
Today, well, or any day.
Well, it goes up and down, right? COVID fatigue is real. And November and I, in general, aren't friends. But overall, I try to live on the sunny side of the street and maintain my optimism and humor.
Okay. Well, that's honest and fair enough. And so I hear that, though. I think that so many of us are certainly challenged and there's a lot of stress and anxiety out there. So what do you find that helps you during times like this?
My cat, when we're not fighting, and creating and talking to people and really being hopeful. Since this happened at the beginning of the year, I just keep asking myself, where's the opportunity and what are the possibilities?
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of where I'm living at. I'm on sabbatical from treating people in person with acupuncture. I care for my parents. My dad has cancer. So it's really been a shift to see what's really important and where the joy is. And for me, that's in knitting and sewing, creating things out of fiber.
You know, that's interesting. As I'm having these conversations, as a matter of fact, we just got off a call with another guest, and we're essentially, you know, some common threads and themes. You know, during this time, we are in many ways, you know, some of us have lost our jobs or lost our current livelihoods, and we're having to kind of take a step back and maybe find comfort and joy in the little things and rediscover maybe what's really important, and perhaps, you know, stretch ourselves and do some recreating of ourselves as well.
Oh, I think that's so important. I'm taking a couple classes now to up-level my skill set, really help this transition into the next phase of my life. Because, you know, as much as Americans like to view themselves as being uber independent as humans, it's just not true. That we need people in our corner to help us get to where we want to be.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. We are even the most introverted of us out there. I mean, we need humans. I mean, we're social creatures. Humans are social creatures is what I'm trying to say, right?
Yeah, yeah. And as an introvert that is very happy to be home, mm-hmm. I still need people.
Yeah, I'm the same. I'm exactly. I have a feeling we have a lot in common because you mentioned your cats. I am a big cat person. I mean, Sammy and Winston, bless their hearts, they get more kisses and fussed over throughout their day. You just have, you probably do have an idea.
Yeah.
Anyway, they really, our pets are a huge source of comfort. But no, I'm the same way. Even before this whole pandemic, I have, been working from home for a number of years now. And for the most part, pretty content to be by myself. But, you know, I do need to get out once in a while and I do need to interact. And mm-hmm. I do find it does energize me to do it once in a while. And then that's one of the reasons why I love podcasting. I get to talk to so many interesting people like yourself. And I'm just on cloud nine for a long time after we do one of these shows. It's so much fun.
Oh, awesome. Yeah, I was excited to be invited. So thank you so much.
Of course. And there's so many things like I'm really curious about your time at sea and what kind of a boat do you still have a boat? And
I don't have a boat. The only thing around me are rivers. So I really do look forward to moving back to the sea. But it was just a childhood dream that I had of going sailing, going offshore and living on a boat in the Caribbean. And so when I was in college, I almost quit and did that, but I waited. I finished my degree and I got on I talked my way onto a 70-foot sailboat and we went to the Caribbean and I was a charter cook.
Wow. How long did you do that for?
I was in the islands for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. I ended up meeting somebody, as often the case, and sailing with him. I also did a delivery from Southern California. I was a deckhand on a 47-foot boat. We went down the west coast of Central America through the canal, which is a feather in any sailor's cap, mm-hmm. and back to the Leeward Islands where I was based out of. So I did a lot of offshore and inshore sailing. I have double-handed two people back and forth from the Caribbean to New England. I did that three legs. When I was trying to figure out what to do with myself, you know, finding my calling in life, it was acupuncture or boat captain. So I went back down to the islands and worked on a lot of different boats. And everywhere I went, people talked about acupuncture. So that's what I ended up doing. But it's always been my passion is the sea. And I taught sailing for many years in New England and in Southern California. I just love it. And I miss it.
Well, yeah. You'll get back there. I'm sure
you'll get there.
You will. And I'm not even, I don't even know where you are right now. Where do you live right now? I know the Midwest, but that's all.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. There's a little lake nearby where I actually grew up sailing. It's just the winds are fluky, which makes you a good sailor. It's just not satisfying.
Yeah, you want to be out in the open sea, and so was that your where you grew up? Is that where you're from?
Yeah, I'm from Pittsburgh. I grew up here, went to college. I started going to Cape Cod to work during the summers in college, and it's been 8 years actually this week.
Okay.
But I moved back to Pittsburgh because my dad has cancer. So I moved back here to spend time with him and to help them. And we've gotten extra years, a new drug, a pacemaker, you know, all those things that happen when you're in your 80s. And he's an amazing rebound artist. We call him the comeback kid. We don't know how many more lives he has left. That's how, but, you know, it's a privilege to, be of service.
Yeah. Well, do you have siblings there with you? Are you it?
I do have siblings and mm-hmm. each person has their niche, right? Mm-hmm.
Well, he's blessed, and you and your siblings are blessed too to have each other and have this time with your dad. So I'll keep him in my prayers, and he keeps coming back, right? Kind of like that comeback kid.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I just have to point out though that my parents have a very unique relationship where they're one of the few people that really found their true love. Mm-hmm. And so that connection that they have really keeps them going.
Oh, that's so nice. I got goosebumps. That's cool. Thanks for sharing that. That's really special.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
They are.
Well, one of my goals, I think you might have heard in the intro, is just kind of, you know, sharing, because I'm, you know, we're talking to people from parts of the USA, but also different countries, and just share a little bit. Like, I've never actually been to Pittsburgh, and I'm sure there are things that are really cool about Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So what are some things you love about living there?
Well, there's a lot of cultural stuff, actually, and mm-hmm. it's high end and low end.
Okay.
Andre Previn was the conductor of the symphony here for many years, for example.
Mm-hmm.
That there's always been a very strong cultural heritage, whether it's the symphony, the opera, dance, whether it's ballet or modern. The museums are fantastic. We have the Warhol Museum, which is part of the Carnegie Group, which is the Museum of Natural History, Science, and the Art Museum. And they've had what they call the Carnegie International for over 100 years. And they had a retrospective a few years back, and it was amazing the caliber of artists that were new at that time that are well-known names now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and then we have the quirky, like Randy Land, where there's an artist that just like puts all this stuff, decorates his house with all the oddities, mm-hmm. right? Like Portland, Oregon or Austin, Texas, the phrase keep it weird is applied here as well.
I love it. That's fun. That sounds fun. Randy Land.
Randy Land, it's on the north side, yeah, near the Mexican War streets. There's an installation gallery over there called the Mattress Factory, because that's what it was at one point. But they do installations that they keep in there for a while, and they also have a lot of really cool stuff.
Cool. Well, and I think my husband and I were out for dinner, not in recent times, last few months, and we met a nice couple, and they had moved here from Pittsburgh, and they were mm-hmm. telling us, we got on the subject of beer because we were all drinking a nice craft beer, but they were telling us that you guys have quite a craft brewery, district or something. I'm not sure exactly. Maybe you know what I'm talking about, but.
Two separate things. One, there is a lot of craft beer in the area.
Mm-hmm.
Two, the Strip District is where all the produce used to come in by trains. Mm-hmm. So there are a lot of businesses like that, whether it's Italian or Asian or whatever. It's a lot like Haymarket in Boston, if you've ever been up that way.
Yeah.
Which it makes it very unique. I'm not a beer drinker myself. I prefer my single malts.
mm-hmm, okay.
So here's an interesting tidbit. To pay for the Revolutionary War, Alexander Hamilton initiated a whiskey tax. And Pittsburgh, Allegheny County, was the biggest producer of whiskey in the country at that time. And so actually a lot of the distillers here went south. So like Jim Beam and Jack Daniels and all of those bourbons would have